गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। सो इन टुडेज सेशन वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस क्वेरी लैंग्वेजेस। इन द लास्ट सेशन वी हैड अ डिस्कशन रिलेटेड टू द कीज इन रिलेशनल मॉडल। Prior to that, we had a discussion related to few of the important terminologies those are being used in relational model. So I hope you must have understood all those concepts, right? Today we are going to start discussing query languages. In our further discussion, we are going to refer to our running example of university database, and we are referring to this relational schema for our university database. So I want you to remember this relational schema, or you should always have the copy of this relational model with you, because whatever queries we are going to write henceforth, or whatever task we are trying to do to understand the concepts related to query languages, we are referring to this relational model. And I want always you should know, or you should have this copy of relational model with you, right? So that you can write the expressions in query languages, right? So if you are not having this model, I would recommend you, I'll be giving you 2-3 minutes to draw this relational model in your notebook. So always you need to refer to this now, this relational model. Okay, now the same relational model is also being depicted in terms of all the relations along with the schema. So all the relational schemas are being depicted over here. So department is having 3 attributes: department name, building, budget. Course is having attributes: course ID, title, department name, credits. Instructor is having the attributes ID, name, department name, and salary. Student is having the attributes ID, name, department, and credits. Classroom, building, room number, and capacity. Section is having the attributes course ID, section ID, semester, year. Building, room number, time slot ID. Teachers having the attributes ID, course ID, section ID, semester, year. Relation text having the attributes ID, course ID, section ID, semester, year, grade. Advisor having 2 attributes SID, IID. Time slot is the relation with attributes time slot ID, day, start time, end time. And prerequisite is the relation with 2 attributes course ID, prerequisite ID. The underlined attributes are forming actually the primary key for the respective relations. And all those relations are having some foreign keys. So these foreign keys can be depicted here in this pictorial diagram. So which is the foreign key, and this foreign key is related with which primary key in another table. Say for example, if we look at this text table, then ID is the foreign key in this text table, and this foreign key is borrowed from the referenced relation, that is student. So we are having pictorially shown that this ID is foreign key and that is borrowed from student. Similarly, course ID, section ID, semester and year. These four attributes are borrowed from this table section. So respective links are being shown here. And in text relation, ID, course ID, semester ID, semester year, these five attributes are underlined, meaning these five attributes together are forming the primary key for this text relation, right? So here our primary key is composite, meaning the primary key is having several attributes. So together those attributes are forming the primary key for this text relation. And similar is the case for the remaining relations. So please understand this relational schema. In fact, we had a detailed discussion earlier about this relational schema. So now with this relational schema, we are going to proceed further. Okay. So today, as I mentioned, we are going to talk about the query languages. So query language is the language in which user requests the information that is stored in the database. In unit number one, we have seen that the query languages are categorized as the procedural language and non-procedural language, right? So we have already seen what we mean by procedural language and what we mean by non-procedural language. In procedural languages, we need to provide the information like what we would like to extract and how to extract. That is why this kind of language is known as procedural. We need to mention in the statement what we would like to extract and how to extract that information. In non-procedural languages, we only mention what to extract. How to extract that information need not be provided in non-procedural language. So in non-procedural language, only we mention the information that what we would like to extract from the database. And how to extract that, we are not going to provide any such kind of information in non-procedural language. Now, these pure languages now are of three kinds here, mentioned as relational algebra, tuple relational calculus, and domain relational calculus. So relational algebra is the procedural language. So while using the statements in relational algebra, we need to mention what we would like to extract, and also we need to mention how to extract that information, right? Whereas in tuple relational calculus and domain relational calculus, being these two are the non-procedural pure languages, we are mentioning what needs to be extracted from the database, but we are not providing the information like how to do that. Okay, so in this section of this unit, we are going to focus upon all these three pure languages. In fact, these pure languages form the underlying basis for the query languages that we are making use of. Say for example, we are going to use SQL, that is the structured query language, right? And the structured query language is the popular query language that is being used to extract the information from the relational database model. Okay, but underlying this structured query language or SQL, we are having this relational algebra. And that is why prior to going for SQL, we are going to learn first this relational algebra, right? Because this relational algebra forms the basis for SQL, that is structured query language, that is the most popular language for the relational database management systems, right? So let's proceed with the relational algebra now. So as I mentioned, this relational algebra is the procedural query language. Procedural query language. And in relational algebra, we are having six basic operations or six fundamental operations. And these fundamental operations are the select operation, project operation, union, set difference, Cartesian product, and rename operation. So these six are the basic operations of relational algebra. We are first going to focus upon these six basic operations. And later on, based on these basic operations, we are having few extended operations in relational algebra. So after learning all these six basic operations, we are going to look at these extended operations. Okay, now see here, this select operation, project operation, and rename operations are the unary operations, whereas union operation, set difference operation, and Cartesian product operation, these three operations are binary operations. So what we mean by unary operation and what we mean by binary operation? The operations, those are unary operations, those require a single relation to work with. So select, project, and rename operations take one relation as the input. So these three operations operate upon a single relation, and that is why we say that these are the unary operations. Whereas union, set difference, and Cartesian product needs two relations to operate upon. So these three operations require two relations as input. And that is why these three operations are the binary operations. Whatever we are looking at here, these notations are actually the Greek symbols. And these symbols are denoting these relational algebra operations. So we are going to make use of these notations, right, to write the query in relational algebra. So select operation is using the sigma, that is the Greek letter. Okay, this project operation is using this Greek symbol pi. Okay, that is the projection symbol or projection notation. Union, so the associated symbol or notation is being depicted over here. So while writing the relational algebra query, we are going to make use of these notations, right? So once again, I am listing out six basic operations are there under relational algebra: select operation, project operation, union, set difference, Cartesian product, and rename. Out of these six basic operations, select, project, and rename operations are unary operations because they need only one relation as input to operate upon. Whereas remaining three operations, union, set difference, and Cartesian product operations, require two relations to operate upon, and hence these are the binary operations. Please note here that all these basic relational algebra operations require a relation as input, and they are producing a new relation as the output. So input to these operations is a relation in relational model, and these operations are producing a new relation as the output or the result. Am I clear? May I proceed? Yes, may I proceed?
Yes, ma'am.
Fine. So, let us start our discussion with the first relational algebra operation, and that is the select operation. Okay? Select operation help us to select the tuples from the relation that satisfy a given predicate. And the notation is like this. So the select operation is denoted by making use of this Greek letter sigma. Right? As I mentioned, this select operation is unary operation. And that is why this select operation requires one relation R to operate upon, and this takes one predicate P. So P stands for a predicate. Predicate is the condition that we are providing. Okay, so P here is called as the selection predicate, and this select operation is defined like this. So this is a formal definition for our select operation. So the select operation operates upon a relation R with predicate P. And how to define this select operation? This will provide us this set of tuples T. The set of tuples T such that T belongs to relation R, and the predicate is true for tuple T. I'll repeat once again what this select operation is doing. This select operation is giving me the set of tuples T such that the tuple belongs to relation R and it satisfies the predicate P. Predicate is nothing but a condition. Okay, so this is a formal definition for our select operation. So as I mentioned, P is the formula in propositional calculus consisting of the terms. And these terms are connected by the connectives and, or not. And each term is one of the attribute, operator, attribute, or of the form attribute, operator, constant. I'll repeat, this predicate is a formula. And that formula is written in propositional calculus. So this formula P consists of several terms. These terms are connected by the connectives like AND operator, OR operator, NOT operator. Right? And these terms are actually of the form attribute, operator, attribute, or attribute, operator, constant. So what this OP operator is? This operator is one of the comparison operators like equal to, not equal to, greater than equal to, less than, or less than equal to. So this operator is one of the comparison operators. Right? So attribute is compared with another attribute, or attribute is compared with the constant. And I'm having several such terms which are connected by these connectives. And these connectives are AND or NOT, logical operations. Right? So this is how I'm going to define my predicate P. So ultimately, this select operation will provide me the tuples from this relation R such that these tuples are satisfying the predicate P. And mathematically, this select operation is written like this. It is the set of tuples T such that T belongs to relation R, and this tuple T satisfies the predicate P. So P of T is true. Right? So let me give you one example now of select operation. Let us assume that we are having the relation R. In this relation R, we are having four attributes A, B, C, D. So A, B, C, D are the attributes of relation R. And whatever you are looking at right now is one of the instances of this relation. So in this instance of relation R, we are having four tuples as denoted here. Four tuples. Right? Now, let us write this select operation now. How I am going to write the operation and what I want to extract. Let us assume that I want to extract from this relation R the tuples for which attribute A is equal to attribute B and D, value of D is greater than 5. What I want to extract? I want to extract the tuples such that value of A is equal to value of B and value of D is greater than 5. So how I am going to write the query in relational algebra? I am going to make use of this select operation in relational algebra. So how I am going to write this query? This select operation takes this relation R as the input. And what is the predicate here? And the predicate here is this: A equal to B and D is greater than 5. So this is my condition, this is my predicate. So this condition will be applied on relation R. Okay, and what I am getting is this output. So this is my output. So what I am getting? I will be extracting only those tuples for which A is equal to B. So in this tuple I am having A equal to B. For this tuple I am having A equal to B. For this tuple also I am having A equal to B. But I am having one more condition, and. And is the logical operator. So both the conditions need to be satisfied simultaneously here, because we are having ANDing operation. So what is this other condition? D should be greater than 5. So if I look at this tuple, whether D is greater than 5? Yes. So I need to pick this tuple. For this tuple, whether D is greater than 5? No. So the second condition is not satisfied, and that is why I will not take this tuple. What about this third one? A equal to B? Yes. And whether D is greater than 5? Yes, it is. So I need to pick this tuple as well. So in my result, I'll be getting a new relation wherein I'll be having these two tuples. Those are satisfying my predicate P. So this is my predicate P. So in output, I'll be getting a relation wherein I'm having few of the tuples. And which are the tuples? Those are included in my output. The tuples, those are satisfying this predicate P. So this is how our select operation works. Any doubts so far? Yes.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, what about column C? In the query, it haven't mentioned that we have to take column C.
Yes. So, see here, in selection operation, right? All the columns are being considered. not necessarily we are supposed to provide the condition for every column. Whatever may be my predicate, that is okay. It may happen that I am having only one condition, A equal to B, that's all. So I'll be extracting the tuples that satisfy this condition. I'll be extracting all the columns. So select operation will not affect the column. Right? It is only extracting the tuples from the original relation, satisfying my predicate. That's all. Right? Any doubt? Got the concept? Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
So let's proceed now with one more example, or rather few more examples for select operation. And we are now referring to our university database. So please refer to the relational model that you have. Okay? What we would like to do is, we would like to extract instructor information pertaining to computer science department. What we would like to extract? We want to extract instructors from computer science department. Okay? So, let us assume that this is our instructor table, instance of our instructor relation. Right? So in this instructor relation instance, I'm having those many instructors stored in this table. Right? Now, what I want to extract the instructor information pertaining to computer science department. So here we are providing the predicate. What is the predicate? Predicate says that the instructors should be from department name equal to computer science. Right? So this will form my predicate. So I'll be using a statement like select which relation to be used, because instructor information is present in instructor relation. So I need to make use of this relation instructor. The relational algebra operation to be used is select operation. What I want to select? I want to extract only the data of the instructors pertaining to computer science department. So the predicate is department name equal to computer science. Right? Department name equal to computer science. So if I write such kind of a relational algebra statement, what I'll be getting as the output? I'll be getting another relation as the output. So whether this first tuple will be included? Yes, this tuple gets included in my final output because this instructor belongs to computer science department. Then this, no, predicate is not satisfied. For all these tuples, predicate is not satisfied. For this tuple, yes, department name is computer science. For this tuple, department name is computer science. So in my result, what I will have is, I will have these three tuples. Those are satisfying my predicate. And what is the predicate here? Predicate is department name equal to computer science. So this would be my output. So output is one relation, new relation, that is satisfying this predicate. Got it? Any doubt? Yes? Yes. Any doubts?
No, ma'am.
May I proceed with the next?
Yes, ma'am.
Fine. So let us try now this query. Find all instructors with salary greater than 70,000. Write the query in your notebook. 5, all instructors with salary greater than 70,000. So which relation to be used? Which relation to be used? Yes.
Instructor.
Instructor, correct. So we are having this instructor relation, instance of instructor relation. So you are supposed to write the query now. How to write the query? Yes? Any answer? What would be the predicate? Salary greater than 70,000 would be the predicate, right? Which relation to be used? Instructor. And which operation to be used? Select operation. So we are writing the query like this. Select from instructor all those tuples satisfying this predicate. Salary is greater than 70,000. And how many tuples will be there in my output? Yes? How many tuples? Whether the first tuple would be there in my output? Yes?
Eight
tuples. So this will not be there. This will be there. This will not be there. This will be there. Once again, this would not be there in my output. This will be there. Cats will be there. This will not be there. This will be there. This, this, and this. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 tuples there in my output. Got it? Yes.
Yes.
Any doubts so far? Any doubts so far? Yes. Got it?
Yes, ma'am.
Fine. Now let us try one more. Find the instructors in computer science with a salary greater than 70,000. Write the query. Find the instructors in computer science with a salary greater than 70,000. So once again, the relation to be used is instructor. Write the query. Done? Anybody who can give me the answer?
Select department name is equal to com science and salary greater than 70,000 from instructor.
Correct. So this is how we need to write the statement. The select operation, right? The operand is instructor. Right? And this is my predicate. So predicate is department name equal to computer science and salary is greater than 70,000. So simultaneously, both of these conditions should be satisfied. Then only we'll say that this tuple is satisfying the predicate. Okay? So if we look at our instance of instructor table, right? We have already identified earlier that computer science people, there are 3 instructors from computer science. But now, once again, we need to check whether the salary is greater than 70,000, right? So for this first instructor, salary is 65,000. So it is less than 70,000. So this will not be included in the final result. What about this computer science person? Yes, greater than 70,000. The third person, yes, greater than 70,000. So in my final output, I'll be having two tuples like this. Correct? Yes. Any doubt? Any doubt? May I proceed?
No, ma'am.
May I proceed?
Yes, ma'am.
Fine. So I think you must have understood the first relational algebra operation, that is select operation. Okay? So let's proceed to the next operation, that is project operation. So notation for this project operation is like this. So we are having this Greek symbol pi, right? This is also unary operation. So it takes one relation as the operand. Okay? And what we have here is, we are having the list of attributes a1, a2 up to ak. Right? So a1, a2 up to ak are the attribute names. Right? And R is the name of the relation. So, what this project operation is actually doing? This project operation will provide me a new relation where I will be having the attributes, those are depicted over here, k attributes, a1, a2 up to ak. So, whichever are the attributes, those are provided. In my output, I will be having those many columns. Right? So, if I want to omit few of the columns from the original relation R, then I may use this project operation. So, this project operation takes R as the input, that is the relation, and whichever are the attributes, those are mentioned in the list. Only those many columns I'll be having in my output. Right? So it is possible for me to pick only the columns or only the attributes. Those are required. Okay? Now, one more important point to be noted here is, if there are any duplicate rows or duplicate tuples, those are being removed from the result, because ultimately this relation is the set, and if I am having this set, the duplicate rows or the duplicate entries are removed from my result. Okay, let us see one example first, so that you can understand whatever we are talking about. Let us assume that we are having this relation R with three columns A, B, C, and we are having these four tuples. So this is one of the instances of my relation R, right? With four tuples. Now, I am having this statement like project A, C on R. So R is the relation, input relation, and I want to use the project operation with attribute list A and C. So what it will provide me? It will provide me only these two columns of R. So I am removing temporarily. See, this is a new relation that is being created. Original relation will be as it is. We are not at all removing any column from original relation. The original relation R will be as it is. Only we are creating the output as the new relation, wherein I'll be having these two columns A and C. Right? So whatever are the values of those columns for respective tuples, those values I'll be having, no doubt. Okay, so only by omitting this particular column B, I am having here the new relation with two columns AC. Right? Whatever is the data for all those four tuples for these two attributes, that data will remain as it is. Okay? Now, what we mentioned is, if I am having any duplicate tuples now, those duplicate tuples will be removed. So what we mean by that, whenever I have selected only A and C, it happens that I am having these two tuples with same values. So these are the duplicate tuples now, alpha 1, alpha 1. So in my output, I will be having this alpha 1 tuple only once. Right? So duplicate tuples are being removed. And what would be the output? Output would be two columns AC and three tuples, alpha 1, beta 1, beta 2. Right? Got it? If you have any doubts, please let me know. Yes? Any doubts? Yes? May I proceed?
No, ma'am.
May I proceed?
Yes, ma'am.
Fine. So, let us see now one example from our university schema. So what we would like to do is, we would like to extract instructor ID, name and salary. So what I want to extract ID of the instructor, name of the instructor and salary of the instructor. So how I'm going to write this statement? Using project operation, project ID, comma, name, comma, salary, because these attributes I would like to extract from instructor table. My instructor table, so I do not want this department name. I do not want this department name. And that is why I am writing such kind of a project operation. Okay, so the output getting is like this. I'll be having ID, name, salary, three columns, okay, and all the values belonging to all those tuples will be as it is. Only thing is, I have removed this department name column. Please note that I am not removing that column physically, right? Department name will be as it is in my instructor relation. Only by using this statement, we are creating a new relation. We are creating a new relation wherein we are not having this department name attribute. Okay, so instructor table will be as it is. Right? Are you getting me? Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
Fine. So let's proceed now with the next operation. We'll see this operation and then we'll conclude the session. And in the next session, we'll talk about remaining three operations. Okay, so this is the third operation, that is union operation. So notation of union operation is this Greek symbol union. Okay, and as we have mentioned, this is the binary operation. So what we mean by binary operation? Binary operation means it requires two operands. So it takes two relations as input. So R is one relation and S is another relation. So union operation is binary in nature, and that is why it requires two operands. R and S are the operands here. So formally or mathematically, how to describe this union operation? The union operation is described like this. R union S equal to, it is giving me the set of tuples T. It is giving me set of tuples T such that T belongs to R or T belongs to S. So it is collecting the tuples from both the relations R and S such that T is there in R or T is there in S. Okay, now to perform this operation, we need to validate two conditions. So what are those two conditions? For our union S to be valid, we need to make sure that these two conditions are satisfied. So what are those two conditions? R and S must have the same arity. To perform union operation, what is required is, whatever are the two relations, those are participating here, these two relations must have the same arity. What is arity? Arity means the number of attributes must be same. Arity means number of attributes. So R and S, both the operands, must have same arity, same number of attributes. That is the first condition. If the number of attributes in the operand relations R and S are different, then it is not possible to perform union operation. Right? So for union operation to be valid, the first condition that should be satisfied is the number of attributes in both the relations R and S must be the same. Okay? What next? The next condition says that the attribute domains must be compatible. The attribute domains must be compatible. What does this mean? This means that the domains of the ith attribute of R and ith attribute of S must be the same for all I's. What does this mean? See, suppose I am having R and S, two relations. Okay? And we are having, let us assume that two attributes in R and S respectively. Okay? And if we want to perform R union S, then the first condition says that we should have equal number of attributes, same number of attributes in both R and S. So that condition is satisfied over here, because we are having exactly same number of attributes in R and S, two attributes. Okay? So first condition is satisfied. What second condition says? Second condition says that the attribute domains must be compatible. So this is my first attribute here, and this is the first attribute in S. So whenever I am performing union operation, what is mandatory is the respective attribute domains must be compatible. Or in other words, I may say that suppose I am referring to this first column of R and I am referring to this first column of S, then the type of values of these two columns must be same. So if this column is string, then this column must also be the string. If this column is having some numeric values, then this first column must also have the numeric values. Then only we say that this first column and this first column is compatible. And similar should be the case for all columns, right? So all the respective columns in both the relations must be compatible. Means they should have the similar domains. Okay? Getting me? Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
Fine. So let's proceed now with one example. So this is our union operation. So we are having two relations R and S. So R is having two columns AB. S is also having two columns AB. Okay? And if we look at the values, these are, or these attributes are compatible. Right? Both the relations are having two attributes, so same number of attributes. And also the attribute domains are compatible. right? So this first column and this first column are having the similar values. This second column and this second column are having the similar values, similar domains. So we can perform the union operation for these two relations. Okay, so if I perform R union S, what I would get? I would get all the tuples. So tuples belonging to R or tuple belonging to S. So what is my mathematical definition? I'll be having the set of tuples T such that T belongs to R or T belongs to S. So I'll be collecting the tuples from both the relations. Okay, so first let us see this R relation R. So I'm having alpha 1, alpha 2, beta 1. So I'm having here alpha 1, alpha 2, beta 1. Now tuples from S also I need to have. Okay, so alpha 2. So I need to add alpha 2 also in the result, but alpha 2 is already present and this is the set operation. So I will not duplicate this tuple because it is already there. It is union, right? And in union, in the final result, we will not be having the duplicate tuples. Okay, what about this beta 3? Yes, beta 3 is new tuple. So I will be adding this beta 3 in my output. So in my output, I'll be having four tuples. So R union S is whatever you are seeing here on this slide. So union of R and S. Got it? May I proceed? May I proceed?
Yes, ma'am.
Fine. So now, let's see one example for union from our university schema. So, we are supposed to find the set of all courses taught in the fall 2009 semester, the spring 2010 semester, or both. Find the set of all courses taught in fall 2009 semester, the spring 2010 semester, or both. Now refer to your relational model. Refer to your relational schema that you have drawn for this university database and tell me which relation to be used, where that information is, in which table we are having that information. Yes. Refer to your schema. Anybody? Where is the information available? Which section, which course is being taught? In which semester, which year? Yes.
Section.
Section, yes, very true. So we are having the section relation and we need to make use of that section relation. So this is one of the instances of our section relation. So we are having here course ID, section ID, semester, year, building, room number and time slot ID. What we want to find the set of all courses taught in fall 2009 semester. And also we want to look for the courses in spring 2010 or both. So these many courses we need to extract. Now, whenever we are saying we would like to extract the courses, we would like to extract this course ID. Such that this semester is fall, year is 2000, or this semester is spring and year is 2000. right? So see here the thought process now. So what we can do is we can split this task. We can split this task in such a way that first we will extract the tuples from this relation section, those satisfy this first predicate, that is the course to be taught in fall 2009 semester, right? Then we will find all those tuples for the courses, those are taught in spring 2010. So we are splitting our task. First of all, we'll extract the courses, those are taught in fall 2009. Then we will extract the courses, those are taught in spring 2010. And then we may collect the tuples together. Okay, so see here how we are going to write the query. As I mentioned, first of all, we are going to find the set of all courses taught in fall 2009 semester. To do this, we are going to write the query like this. See here, we are making use of two relational algebra operations. And I'm going to justify what we are trying to do. What we want to extract, we want to extract the courses. So courses means we would like to extract course ID. We do not want to extract all the attributes. Those are present in this section relation. Only we are interested in finding out the courses. That means we are interested in course IDs only. Okay. Now, what else? We want to make use of this information, summer, semester, and year. So we need to provide the predicate here for the select statement. So we are making use of first this select statement. Okay, so select statement requires the operand, that is the section relation, and the predicate here is semester equal to fall and year equal to 2009. Right, so this inner relational will provide me all the tuples from section relation, those satisfy this condition. And what is the condition? Semester equal to fall and year equal to 2009. So obviously, this inner expression will give me the tuples, those are satisfying this predicate. So I'll be getting the tuples related to the courses, those are taught in fall 2009. Okay, so see here, this select statement will provide me this data. See, select is fall and year is 2009. Semester is fall and year is 2009. So I'll be having these three tuples, entire these three tuples in my result. Okay, now on this relation, this is my intermediate relation, temporary relation, intermediate relation. Okay, now on this result, intermediate result, what I'm trying to do? I am providing one more operation, relational algebra operation, and that is the projection operation. So I'm not interested in all those attributes, but I'm interested only in course ID. So out of all those attributes, what I'll do? I'll pick only course ID. So after having this entire statement executed, what I'll get is, I'll get only these course IDs. Correct? Whatever we have done? Yes? Have you understood whatever
yes,
we have
ma'am.
Done? Fine.
Yes, ma'am.
So, what we have got now? We have got? What we have got? We have got the course IDs. Those are taught in fall 2009. Okay. Similarly, what we are going to do next is we are going to find out the course IDs. Those are taught in spring 2010 semester. Right. So, in the similar way, we are going to write the statement. Only thing is the condition, the predicate is different. And what that predicate is? This predicate is semester equal to spring and year equal to 2010. So this inner query will provide me the result like this. So what I'll be having? I'll be having the tuples, right? Those satisfy spring 2010. Spring 2010. This is spring 2010. This is also spring 2010. Okay? Spring 2010. This and this. So all those green, all those tuples marked in green color, those are being extracted as a result of this select statement. Okay? Now, on this result, so this is my intermediate result. So what next I'll be doing is, from this relation, I want only this course ID. So I'm having the projection operation with the attribute course ID. So out of all those, I'll be extracting only course ID, and whatever I'm getting is this. So only course ID attribute is being extracted from this result. Got it? Yes? Any doubts so far? Any doubts so far?
No. Yes.
May I proceed now?
Yes, ma'am.
Fine. So we are having now these two intermediate results. So I am having the course IDs, those for courses taught in fall 2009, and I am having the course IDs for the courses, those are taught in spring 2010. So what next I would like to do is, I would like to combine these two results. So ultimately, my query will look like this, right? So this is the first part of the query, and I have demonstrated you the result, intermediate result. This is the part, second part of the query. Okay, I have explained you the result of this. So this first part is giving me this result, intermediate result. The second part of the query is giving me this result, and I am using now the union of these two results. So I'll be having the union operation on these two intermediate relations. Now, if I'm using union operation, I need to satisfy two conditions. The first condition says that the arity of the relations must be the same. So arity means number of attributes must be the same. Yes, both the relations are having only one attribute. And the domains of the respective attributes must also be compatible. So here also I am having course ID, here also I am having course ID, no issues, domains are same. So it is possible to perform union operation over here. And after performing the union operation, what I'll be getting is this final result. Okay, this is my final result. So what is in this result? Union of these two tables. So CS109, yes, so it is present in both. So it appears only once. Then CS315, CS319. So two sections are being taught. So it comes two times here. So I'll be having only one entry for that. CS347, I'll be having that. Okay, then these two courses, Okay, so this is the course in the output. Then physics 101 is there and music 199 is there. So all those tuples are being included in my final output of union. Got it? Yes, any doubt so far?
Hello?
Any doubt?
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes.
Can't we refer the teacher's relation for this example?
Yes. See, in teachers also we are having that data. We may use that also, okay? But why we have selected this section? Because teachers, see, if we look at the semantics, okay, then storing the data that which course is taught by which teacher. Which course is taught by which teacher, right? And in section, we are having the detailed information that which section belonging to which course is taught in which semester year. So in fact, in this particular problem, we are not at all bothered with the teachers who are teaching the course. We want to only find out the courses, those are taught in this particular semester and year. No doubt, we may use this teacher's relation as well, right? But in fact, if we look at the semantics, right, then it is more appropriate to use this section relation. Because individual section along with individual course is mentioned. Which course is taught by taught in which semester and in which year. And that is why we have used this section relation over here. Okay. Yes. Any more doubts? Any doubts?
Hello.
Okay. Yes.
Suppose, ma'am, before performing union operation, if we are having course ID and course name, then we are able to form result because we are having two columns. One is course ID and another is course name on both
sides.
Where
is course name? Where is course name available? In the course table. No. Why to go for course table here right now?
No, no, ma'am. I am asking.
Okay. So, I am giving you the other way how we can write this query. Okay? So, how we can write this query? We are having the output of this select statement, output of this select statement. So, what we can do is, we can first perform the union of these two tables. Union of these two tables. And then we can have this projection with course ID attribute. So, is we can write this query as this select operation union this select operation and to the output of this union at the outer side we may put this projection operation with course ID. That is how we can provide the query in other way, right? But as you are talking about course name right now, we are not considering course name, right? If we would like to have course name, then we need to learn few more relational algebra operations so that we can combine the output of two different relations so that we can also have the course name associated, right? Because course name is available in course table. And in course table, this other information which course is taught in which semester and year is not available in my course table. And that is why only course table cannot be used, because I want the information that when that course is being taught, right? But it is possible if I want to include the course name also in the output along with course ID, then I can make use of another table also, that is course. But for that, we need to learn few more operations and then we can write such kinds of queries. Okay, are you getting me? Who asked that question? Whether I have answered your question?
Yes, ma'am, yes.
Okay, fine. So, if you have any kinds of doubts other than this, please let me know. Otherwise, we are going to conclude the session. You are having a quiz today, so you are supposed to respond to the quiz. Any doubts? So tomorrow we are going to focus upon remaining three relational algebra operations. And it is really very interesting, right, to write the queries by making use of these operations. Okay? So let's conclude today. Thank you.